Hey guys, this is part one of a two-part series where I answer your questions about EDS and the diagnostic process. Basically, this is everything I wish I knew before I was diagnosed and looking to get diagnosed because I thought I had it. After this video, please check out the second one. I'm hoping to release it tomorrow. The most common question I get is what kind of doctor can diagnose EDS? In general, the best thing you can search for is actually a clinic that deals with hypermobility, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, or a connective tissue clinic. Now, a lot of major cities have them and big hospitals too, but that's not always an option. And sometimes they actually have extremely long wait lists. The next best thing to do is try to find a geneticist. Now, not every single geneticist knows that much about EDS, specifically the hypermobile type, which is the most common, so that's kind of unfortunate. But they probably are your best bet given that Ehlers-Danlos syndrome is a genetic disorder. Your next best option is a rheumatologist. They do deal with joint pain, mainly though due to autoimmune diseases, but sometimes they see people who have EDS and know how to diagnose it. And then the last two types of doctors that I've had success with, and I've also heard that a lot of you guys had success with, are orthopedists or orthopedic surgeons, and pain management doctors, because EDS is such a painful condition, and pain management doctors do definitely see quite a few EDS patients, and they might actually know how to diagnose it. How common is it? The most common type is the hypermobile type, which is the type that I have. It's also called hEDS, and this occurs in honestly, more than one in every 5,000 people. The reason I say more than is that while that's currently the known statistic, it's considered to be widely underdiagnosed. So it's likely to be a lot more common than that. We don't have any idea right now exactly how common it is. We just know that it is a lot more common than that. The next most common type is the classical type. This occurs in one out of every 20,000 people. And then the next most common type is the vascular type. This occurs in one out of every 250,000 people about. And then some of the other types are the more rare types. Some of them, there have only been a few families found to even have the mutations. But overall, between 80 and 90% of people who have EDS have the hypermobile type. So I hope that helps. Is there a genetic test? So every single type of EDS has a genetic test, a gene mutation associated with it, so they can test for it. For hypermobile EDS, which like I said is the most common, we don't know what the gene mutation is. And that's one of the really big mysteries of this condition, though there are quite a few studies going on right now trying to figure out what that gene mutation is, or if it's multiple, whatever it is. All the other types you can test for, but the hypermobile type, you actually have to do a clinical test that a doctor will run on you. And I actually have a video going through all the criteria, so if you're curious, I'll put it in one of these two corners, I don't know which one, and I'll also link it down below in the description box, as well as some other videos that might be helpful if you're just starting out on your journey. I passed the BEIGHTON score and I'm hypermobile. Does that mean I have EDS? No. A lot of people are hypermobile. In fact, 20% of the population has some sort of hypermobility, whether it be in one joint or a bunch of joints, and they don't have EDS. Hypermobility is usually inherited. Apparently, you can also kind of like create it if you continuously stretch out a ligament like beyond its normal stretchy-likeness, you know, so it's not necessarily good for you, but you can create it as well. It's so much more than hypermobility, and I think that's a misconception sometimes people have. They're like, oh my god, that person's really hypermobile, maybe they have EDS, they probably do, and it's like, no, they like probably don't. Hypermobility is just one of the symptoms of EDS. It's also a symptom of so many other things too that have nothing to do with EDS, you know? I don't know, just for example, Down syndrome. So random, nothing to do with EDS, but it actually can cause hypermobility. So, you know, there are other things that can cause hypermobility that are not EDS. And many of them are not bad things. How similar are all of the types? Some are similar, some are really not. The similar ones that I can think of are hypermobile EDS, classical EDS and classical-like EDS. Maybe there are other ones too that have some closer similarities, but those really three are ones that I think are pretty close. They all come with joint hypermobility everywhere, easy bruising, stretchy skin, poor healing, especially in classical and classical-like. They don't come with facial signs, whereas like vascular, for example, there are certain features that you can see on somebody's face who has vascular EDS sometimes, such as I think eyes that are like far apart or like a very thin nose, something like that. So you can see that not in these types. But then some of the rarer types really are not very similar at all to the three that I just mentioned. Do you have to be hypermobile to have EDS? Yes, you do. Hypermobility is a key feature of all of the Ehlers-Danlos syndromes, and you need to be hypermobile. If you're experiencing EDS-like symptoms without hypermobility, you're totally valid and there's something going on. It's just probably not EDS. Obviously, talk to your doctor. I'm not telling you that. Can you have comorbidities of EDS and not have EDS? Totally. A lot of the conditions that are comorbidities of EDS are actually comorbidities of each other too. So POTS and mast cell activation syndrome, for an example, sometimes go together. They're comorbid. That does not mean you also have EDS. Something else could have caused one of those that then caused the other, or something else could have caused both, or maybe you don't know what that cause is, you just have both. Also, POTS and gastroparesis, they both affect the autonomic nervous system, or more like dysfunction of the autonomic nervous system kind of affects both. So they can be linked, they can be comorbid. Is a diagnosis worth it? Complicated question, and I can't fully answer this for you because that's, you know, a personal decision. What I will say is that, in my opinion, it totally is, and it was worth it for me. Some of the main reasons come down to symptom management, feeling validation, and knowing how to take precautionary measures to prevent problems or to prevent like worsening of your symptoms. For example, I was diagnosed with POTS a few months after EDS, and one of the reasons that I went to the cardiologist was because I already knew what POTS was and I was having a lot of the POTS symptoms. But even if I didn't know about that, getting a diagnosis of EDS would make other doctors maybe suspect something like POTS when you show POTS like symptoms, and then I was able to get treatment. Also, I'm able to manage my pain because I know that I'm not masking something that's potentially dangerous. I actually made a video in the past on why I think a diagnosis is worth it, so I'm gonna link that down below because there's a lot of things I wanna say. But the main thing I wanna say here is that you can't just assume that you have EDS without a diagnosis, because you might think, oh, I think I have EDS, it's not even curable, so why go to the doctor and get diagnosed? Well, what if you don't have EDS and you have something that can be treated? Or what if you have something that's dangerous if you don't treat it? And even still, I understand that diagnosis can be a privilege because it can be really hard to see doctors, but I can't stress enough how important it is to see doctors when you're having these symptoms and not self-diagnose. Is EDS progressive? This is a really common question I get, and the answer is kind of yes and no. I think I personally am leaning more towards yes, but some doctors say no, some say yes, some studies say yes, some studies say no. A lot of symptoms can get worse though, and things like osteoarthritis can start developing or progress as you get older. Breakdown of some connective tissues and like poor, I guess, maintenance of it or whatever within your body can get a little bit worse. But it's not progressive in the same way that some diseases are. Like I'm just gonna say Huntington's disease, and it's progressive at its core. Whereas with EDS, that's not like that, but your symptoms can totally progress. And they don't for everybody, but they do for a lot of people. So just keep that in mind that everybody's different. And I don't think that this is like an argument so much as we just don't really have an answer, but as to like what to call it. So like, don't argue in the comments, be friendly. Can Can you be diagnosed with EDS without a family history or if you're adopted? Yeah, totally. So many people don't have any family history whatsoever or they're adopted and they get diagnosed. The criteria does not require that you have a family member who has it. In fact, it's a really small part of it. Because, you know, if you do have a family that passes the criteria on their own and has the diagnosis, then obviously you're more likely to have it because you might have the same mutation. So it's actually a lot easier to pass the criteria if you have a family history of a close relative having it. But I think most people don't, or if not most, so many people don't. I didn't. I mean, I technically have another family member who has EDS. She's like a distant cousin of mine and she's my age, which is really funny. And so now we're friends and it's nice to know her, but she wouldn't even have helped me get the diagnosis anyway because she's not a close relative. Plus, we're pretty sure my sister probably has EDS. She's not badly affected at all. So I don't even think she would pass the criteria, but she'd be more likely to do it because I do. I hope that you like this video on the basic guide. If you're looking for more information and you want to hear more questions, please go check out part 2, which will be posted just after this. And please subscribe for similar content, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye!